World leader is an opportunity to become someplace that the whole world wants to come see. Well, look at Taiwan. They just completely scrapped their nuclear program and went completely super green, and it's the world's number one example. We're right to do this. I think it'd be silly if the new government didn't do it, because not only would it create a whole new business industry, a whole new segment of business industry. Look, Taiwan already is the world's leader in laptops, right? And 5 of the top 10 businesses that are participating in the AIIB, run by China, to lend money to build infrastructure worldwide, which benefits mainland China, not here. 5 of the 10 are Taiwanese companies. Taiwan has so much power if they exercise it and they put it to something like this. Gold geothermal wave, the title, world leader. A whole world will come here to see that. Like Denmark. Denmark's another one where they have what? Millions of acres of wind turbines in the ocean between Sweden. You'd know this, you're Scandinavian. I also want to say something about innocent countries that have nothing to do with anything getting negative influence. Poor John Lisford lives in North Norway. You'd think that'd be really safe. You'd think that'd be a place that we can all run away to and live happily after hunting reindeer and living on a farm. But guess what? The two places, two of the many places that a half reactor, only one half of a reactor that melted down in Chernobyl, went all over Europe and landed in southern England and northern Norway. So he lives in Timbuktu and it's contaminated with nuclear shit. This stuff is going to go everywhere. And that's just half of one reactor. And we got 4 reactors right to the north of us. Wow. Do you know the other day when there was the 6.8 earthquake? It's 6.8 in southern Japan. 6.2 according to the Taiwanese government. The Japanese government put out an all-national tsunami alert when that earthquake happened last week that we felt. What did Taiwan do? Nothing. No tsunami alert. There was a really high possibility that a 5 to 10 meter tsunami could have come from Okinawa straight to those nuclear plants. There was no warning, no evacuation plan, no nothing. A few hours after the earthquake, Megan and I heard, go bam! For sure we thought that was the nuclear plant. For sure. And we both have emergency back with cash, gold, passport, everything to pay off a fisherman to take us to Penghu, to take us to Xiamen, and get the hell out of this area as fast as possible. Because what else are you going to do? Just sit there and wait till you start rotting from the inside and you poop blood? Because that's what happens. And it's painful, you can't eat, it's a horrible way to die. It's better to commit suicide. In the late 50s, maybe 1956, there was a movie, and all of you should watch this, with Gregory Peck, called On the Beach. And On the Beach was a movie to, like, the opponent of all this fervor for atomic age, nuclear power, so amazing, wonderful. And this guy was brave enough to make a movie called On the Beach, where world nuclear war occurred, and these guys in the submarines were the only guys who were remaining. And they go to Melbourne, Australia, which they figure is the only place they could possibly live without dying, and they die anyway, on the beach. And we're talking, now there's dead dolphins on the beach all over Taipei, Taiwan. How more serious, how many more indicators do we need before we freak out and start doing something as citizens? Really, it's now or never. You know, when that thing blows, it's like, oh, we knew about it all along and we didn't do anything. God, are we stupid or what?
I think it was just a thunderstorm.
Yeah, it was a thunderstorm.
So you wanted to say something?
Yeah, what you said 15% is nuclear energy right now in Taiwan. What's the other 85%
right now? Taiwan is one of the highest percentages of coal energy. energy production. That's not good either. But it kills you much more slowly than nuclear. It doesn't have generational implications. But, you know, many communities, especially central Taiwan, want to shut down their coal plants. Right now is a critical juncture and opportunity for the proliferation of alternative energies. Because coal plants and the communities are saying, we've had enough of this, we're gagging, choking, our children have asthma, allergies, we're suffering, we're not going to restart these plants, shut them down. So the government's going, oh man, see, we need more nuclear. We're going to have to reopen that Roman number 4 plant. That's what they're going to say. They're like the devil for money. So we have to say, what are you talking about? Shut them all down and go green, completely green. And we have the opportunity to become the number one in the world. And I want to appeal to the new government to not just sit back and, because they're talking green, DPP green with the green bands and all that is nice, but what's the exact plans? You know, Tsai Ing-wen, she studied in Cornell, then she went to London School of Economics and law school, and she's economically minded, and she's really sharp. So I really think, if she's elected, I don't know who's going to be, but if she is, that we have a good chance, because we can prove economically now, from an England-based company, that economically it's non-viable anymore. Nuclear, officially, it's gotten more expensive than the alternatives. It used to be the other way around, the business. Plus, Korea just built the world's biggest plant. Are we just going to sit around when we can build a bigger, better plant all over Taiwan? Not just one place or two or three, but all over Taiwan we can build these little... Even Tokyo Bay now, they're putting 20 units, large, each one the size of a building, called Squid. And what they are is, it's wind energy on top and wave tidal energy on the bottom from the waves. So it's always making energy, 24 hours a day. They're putting 20 of those huge things in Tokyo Bay. So we can make them better, cheaper, faster, like laptops here. Great opportunity.
I'd like to add to that, the cost of the fourth nuclear power plant in Taiwan is about almost getting up to $10 billion.
That's correct.
If you look at the amount of megawatts that it produces, and then you compare it to the new tidal power plant in Korea has paid about a third of that cost per megawatt.
And it's already built.
And it's in yield. And it's producing new wind power.
So how did they manage to get that through, huh?
I think the president in Korea is pretty green-minded, green policy.
Progressive. Mm-hmm. Aware of progressiveness, through progressiveness.
So it was from the top down, it wasn't a grassroots thing?
Well, I don't know the details of that, but it has to be built. And I think it was cheap compared to that. I'd like to compare Taiwan and Korea, because it always has this kind of rivalry going on. Mm-hmm.
Samsung, HTC.
Does anybody else have any questions?
Yes.
You said that some of the people in Fukushima had payouts from the government.
Yes, many.
But they still stayed there. I'm wondering why they wouldn't take the money and leave. Why did they stay?
I thought, great, $1 million, get the hell out of here and start a family somewhere else, live happily ever after. But they're so depressed, so upset. They've lost their identity, their job, their work. They're not just have a job. Most of those people up there is multi-generational, like 6 generations of fishermen, 10 generations of farmers. They can't farm anymore, they can't fish anymore. They've had it, emotionally dead. So that's why it splits the family apart, because the wives are much more, you know, what are we doing? Come on, let's, you know, for our kids' future, let's do this, let's get out of here, put them in another school. You know, where they're not forced to eat those local food. Let's get out of it. No. And violence, and then alcoholism, and prostitution, and buying expensive cars. They don't even buy expensive houses. They're still living in the, what's called kasetsu jikaku. It's plastic houses. Row after row after row after row. They're still in there. They're severely depressed. And there is a lack, severe lack, of psychological, psychiatric, social support. It's like mostly just volunteers here and there. It's not intensive enough to help these people emotionally out. So there's this incredible feeling of lack of hope. All hope is lost. I'm going to get some horrible cancer. Our kids are going to die anyway. Screw it. Just blow this money now. Spend it all now. Not everybody, but a lot.
Plus, $1 million doesn't go that far, right? If they have to move to a city and buy an apartment, or I mean, I guess they could rent.
Sometimes it's expensive, but $1 million will go pretty far. Because you can buy an apartment for $300,000. You can, but the thing is, if you're a farmer or a fisherman all your life, where are you going to go and what are you going to do? Well, because the fishing communities are very tight and they don't let outsiders in, you're a Fukushima farmer, get the hell out of here. And Megan and I were having sushi in Tokyo a couple years ago, and I measure tuna, because tuna is a highly bioaccumulated large fish that eats all the fishes down the line, and so I check every time. And at this nice sushi bar in Tokyo, the radiation was 6, 7, 8 times. And Megan's like, you're not going to eat that, are you? Well, I said, it's only 2 pieces and it's expensive and I'm paying for it, so I should probably eat it. But I thought, this is really abnormal. So I talked to the guy in Japanese, the sushi maker guy, and I said to him in Japanese, I said, does this fish come from Fukushima? He said, how do you know? Oh, I'm just guessing. I said, and where are you from? He goes, Fukushima. Oh, so you came down here and found a job as a sushi guy and serving fish from your hometown, probably. Yes. Yeah. What else can I do? And I said, what happened to your family? He said, they all died. You know, with a face that's just completely without hope. And what do I say to that? You can't do that. You know, it's just horrible. So that was one example, one little example of the things that are going on. It gets worse. I went to your hometown, Eugene, and the areas in Oregon, around, like Medford. And I went to a sushi bar, run by Koreans. Sushi, I measured the tuna, was super high. And sorry, but it probably happened in Taiwan as well, where Taiwan was buying all this contaminated stuff. Because I was in Tainan, and one dentist found out that I was a professional golfer too, and he wanted a golf lesson from me. So he ran to the Matsusei and bought a bag of super expensive Japanese apples. You know how they're expensive, one is. And he got a hole. And then, oh, Dr. Joseph, Japanese apples. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm like, let's measure it. Of course it's high, very high. So I gave it to Tony Coolidge. And I'm just saying, we need to be aware of what we eat, where does it really come from, and in our everyday lives, incorporate that in our everyday lives and in our everyday conversations, and get this thing going.
Where do we get one of those?
Well, I just found out that you can get these in Taiwan, so ask your Taiwanese friend to get it cheaper than I got it from Japan.
I think there's time for one more question, or one or two more questions. So kind of on this, what you were just talking about.
Yes.
About, and this, I think it's really good that you told that story about the Fukushima fisherman who moved and opened a sushi shop. So that's, from one perspective, like, what can he really do?
Yeah.
Even though he had $1 million, his options aren't unlimited, right?
Right.
But now talking about, the sushi shop in Oregon, or a sushi shop in Taiwan.
Yeah.
My question is, should it be illegal for stores to sell food with high radiation? And why do you believe it is still not illegal? I mean, besides the money.
Super pertinent question, because I don't know what the official final judgment was, but it was illegal to import food from Fukushima. And then a month ago, the Taiwanese government discovered that the Japanese government was lying and saying that they were selling tons and tons of Fukushima fish and vegetables and everything, and lying and saying that they came from the next prefecture, Ibaraki or something. And so the Taiwanese government parliament was getting together to redraw up a draft that makes all food from Japan illegal. Bam! All food from Japan. And so I don't know what the official ruling was, but perhaps now all fruit from Japan is banned. And that's unfortunate, because most of the food from Japan is okay. And Taiwan has the capacity to really check them all. In Fukushima, they have very expensive machines, not like this. Although this is really high tech, it's accurate within 20%, these little guys. But they have these big ones that fishermen who are still fishing, not for money because they can't sell the fish, but because they want to tell the world that, look, our fish is okay now. So there's still fishermen going out to fish because their boats cost $2-3 million. $1 million money can't even buy another boat. So they bring, they're still fishing, bring the fish, and they bring it to a certain collection agency, and they will measure the radiation of the fish and give you a report. And when I talked to the director of all the fishermen's unions, he said, listen, I don't want to kill my grandchildren. If the fish here is contaminated, I will never give it to them. That's why I fish every day. I bring the fish in, have it measured. And if it's normal, then I give it to my grandchildren. Otherwise, I will never do that, let alone send it to the world. So there's that going on. And the good news is that if you measure the fish and measure the vegetables and it's okay, then it's okay. It's very clear cut. It's either contaminated or it's not.
So, did you start a Facebook page? Is there...
John started the NSA.
Okay, so is that on Facebook? Is that
Shutdown Association?
Well, it's right now it's just a kind of small group just organize stuff.
Using online organizing, or I'm just wondering if there's somewhere like if people watch this in Taiwan who weren't at this speech, if there's somewhere just easy and direct that they can go to without a lot of thought they need to put into it, so maybe starting a database of people that might want to eventually volunteer, et cetera, et cetera.
We're working on starting up a couple of organizations. One is NSA, one is WANKER, World Anti-Nuclear Congress Representatives. And
I'm a WANKER, are you a WANKER?
Her mother called me a WANKER the other day, but that's another story. We will have a couple of Facebook sites, more for foreigners so that we can be more aware of what's going on and share our information with the Taiwanese NGOs and groups that some of which I showed you.
So maybe I could, when you finally do, I could just post a link underneath the video.
Absolutely,
like
and put it to, send it to me, of course, and then I'll send it to our organization and other organizations and anybody else. I can do that and do the same. And let's just spread it out. I gave a talk at Taida about the power of social media. Because remember, like in Egypt, when there was all this oppression going on, and one young girl posted her best friend getting beaten up by the police and face bashed in and killed. And We Are All Ahmed movement started, and revolution started, and they overthrew the government based upon social media. So there's no reason why we can't do the same. And all of us in this room have enough brains, contacts, and mouth to let the proper representatives of government, let alone our friends, know the options, the plans, the opportunities available. We have people in industry, in business, in medicine that have their own companies, graphic designers, doctors. We got everybody just in this room to start a revolution. And because we can get deported by going to a rally, it'd be much more powerful to do it online.
Alright, good. Thanks, Joseph. In a temper of a plan to get rid of itself, it was wrong.
Just crumbled. Thank you very much for listening. Good night.